Mariner Books and Harper Audio present Antidemocratic. Inside the far right's 50-year plot to control American elections. By David Daley. Read by Kevin Stillwell. For Wyatt, who is the best, with hope, joy, and lots of love. The candid citizen must confess that if the policy of the government upon the vital questions affecting the whole people is to be irrevocably fixed by the decisions of the Supreme Court, the people will have ceased to be their own rulers. Abraham Lincoln, First Inaugural Address, March 1861. The most important thing for the public to understand is that we're not a political branch of government. They do not elect us. If they do not like what we are doing, it's more or less just too bad. John Roberts, C-SPAN, October 11, 2009. Introduction. It was a line no one could see. The invisible boundary wrapped around a new Walmart, bisected Interstate 65 in the very center of Alabama, the state at the heart of the fight for the ballot, and stretched the Calera City Council district that Ernest Montgomery represented away from the growing city's downtown. Montgomery's home district was now severed from a black church and neighborhood, and pushed toward wealthy new subdivisions between highways 22 and 31. It would not take long for the political consequences of this line to be seen. Montgomery, just the second black official elected in Calera's history, represented the council's only majority black district. The invisible line, kept hidden from the Department of Justice, despite the requirements of the Voting Rights Act, turned his district from 71% black to nearly 70% white. It traded neighborhoods where double wides sit atop makeshift concrete pillars for those with fancy homes, with Range Rovers and Jeeps in the driveway. The new street names carried a Robin Hood theme, even though in reality it had the opposite effect. It stole from the poor and rewarded the elite. In the next election, Ernest Montgomery lost his council seat by 2 votes. This was a line meant to divide, a line meant to turn back time. And in 2013, it became a line that, after nearly 50 years, finally broke the Voting Rights Act. Today, our democracy teeters in a most perilous position. But we didn't get here overnight. The dangerous state of our elections in America did not come about by accident. Over more than 5 decades, conservatives have plotted our arrival at almost this precise point through a takeover of the courts, extreme gerrymanders, new voting barriers, the creation of new legal theories, and a carefully curated set of right-wing judges to rubber stamp them. The right has worked to refashion the nation in their image, without any concern that elected representatives could be removed from office by the people. America's anti-democratic slide is the product of a deliberate, long-term, and extraordinarily patient strategy, some of it behind closed doors, though much of it in plain sight. America's founders long fretted about a tyranny of the majority. Our Constitution established a representative democracy with a robust system of checks and balances, and a federal government with 3 co-equal branches, all designed to guard against excessive partisanship and factionalism. James Madison, writing in number 10 of the Federalist Papers, suggested this decentralized approach created a happy combination of majority rule with minority protections. Alexander Hamilton, in Federalist 21, suggested that elections would ensure that representatives followed the will of the people. The natural cure for an ill administration in a popular or representative constitution, he wrote, is a change of men. But even elections have proven no match for the right's anti-democratic tyranny of the minority. There are two visions of the nation the white male founders created. In one, best exemplified by Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s description of a moral arc that's long but ever bending toward justice, America first guaranteed the vote to wealthy men. But after a civil war, the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendments to the Constitution that launched Reconstruction, a civil rights movement, women's suffrage, and the Voting Rights Act, VRA, that vision slowly guaranteed a more perfect union where men and women of all races and backgrounds were created equal. The second, darker vision suggests that every step forward arrived with a backlash, that the Reconstruction dream, for example, was smothered by a Supreme Court overeager to assert that the nation had changed, and equality had been achieved, and in a series of cases in the 1870s, all but guaranteed the brutal century of Jim Crow that stood until the passage of the Voting Rights Act in 1965. This precarious moment of American history has been fueled by similar folly by the Supreme Court and similar unease with multiracial democracy. Those federal protections within the VRA had been hard won. The brutal pillars of Jim Crow rule held strong in the former Confederacy before mass protest and principled resistance among disenfranchised black citizens finally made the necessity and urgency of its passage undeniable on what should have marked a centennial of freedom. The regime of post-bellum segregation instituted racial terror in the heart of the modern South. With a century of violence, lynchings, poll taxes, and literacy tests that derailed the post-Civil War dream of Reconstruction, Medgar Evers, John Lewis, Jimmie Lee Jackson, Lamar Smith, and countless other marchers and foot soldiers had wrested the promise of racial justice back from a federally sanctioned system of apartheid with blood or pieces of scalp left behind on Selma's Edmund Pettus Bridge. They were gunned down by whites in broad daylight, on sunlit courthouse greens, in their homes, before frightened families. They were murdered by state troopers, faced clubs and fire hoses, tear gas and attack dogs, all for asserting their most fundamental right across southern cities and small towns, and to ensure it would never happen again in these most stubborn and resistant localities, where neither local officials nor judges could be trusted. The Voting Rights Act required the most horrific offenders, those who met the idea of equality with clubs and guns and dogs, to pre-approve any changes to election laws or voting procedures with the Department of Justice or a federal court in Washington, D.C. After the 1965 Voting Rights Act finally set a multiracial nation on a path toward multiracial democracy that had not been assured even after the Civil War and the Reconstruction Amendments to the U.S. Constitution, the Supreme Court and the forces of regression pulled it backward, in part, all with that district line no one could see, in a city called Calera, located in Shelby County, Alabama. Pre-clearance existed to ensure that otherwise invisible lines like these, the difference between a vote and an actual voice, were drawn fairly. It existed because stubborn pillars of resistance never truly crumbled. Not in the weeks after the VRA's passage, when South Carolina immediately challenged it in federal court as an infringement of state sovereignty. And not in Calera in the mid-2000s when it was lawlessly disobeyed by Alabama officials. And so, in the 2013 U.S. Supreme Court decision in Shelby County v. Holder, this two-mile arc shearing Montgomery's district from its historical moorings also ensnared the VRA. The ever-present American struggle over who wields power has shifted to the U.S. Supreme Court. It's there where that invisible line in Calera intersected with a five-decade conservative strategy to build supremacy in the judiciary. This line no one could see would trap, then suffocate the Voting Rights Act, and concentrate so much power over elections within the courts and gerrymandered Republican legislatures as to create dangerous ramifications for every election still to come. This audiobook tells the story of a modern plot to undermine the most foundational of all rights, the right to vote. It is the story of a plot to advance the most anti-democratic notions of all, that not every vote should count equally, that the institutions of a free nation can be remade to sever them from the will of people, that majority rule could be subverted via election law and the courts. In the last 50 years, this plot has traveled from the fringes of the law to the heart of the Republican Party in such dramatic measure that the party no longer pretends to care about winning elections through such old-school practices as winning more votes than the other side or sustaining a popular mandate for its policies. This most brazen and un-American scheme has proven staggeringly successful. These lines of money, power, and influence were nearly as circuitous and shielded from public view as the lines that pushed Montgomery's district to the frontiers of white exurbia. And they would come to shore up the same extreme agenda. Shelby County and the series of anti-democratic rulings by the Supreme Court, led by Chief Justice John Roberts, represent the hard-fought culmination of a generations-long effort to remake American law, electoral politics, and social hierarchy in the preferred image of a radicalized American right. It emerged out of a concerted, determined effort to build and fund institutions, cultivate conservative legal thinkers, invent and empower a movement in the legal academy known as originalism, place allies on the bench, and remake the nation through the courts. The Shelby County decision was chiefly the handiwork of Chief Justice Roberts, who had launched his legal career as a Reagan-era Justice Department lawyer, contesting voting rights and the reauthorization of the Voting Rights Act. During his Senate confirmation hearings in 2005, Roberts famously declared and promised the American people, "I will remember that it's my job to call balls and strikes, and not pitch or bat." Named by a GOP president, Roberts was a lifelong Republican who had also served on the team of attorneys, alongside his future high court colleagues Amy Coney Barrett and Brett Kavanaugh, that had installed that same president, George W. Bush, in the Oval Office during the controversial 2000 Bush v. Gore decision. Yet he insisted that his approach would be objective and unassuming. "I come before the committee with no agenda. I have no platform," he said. The role of an umpire and a judge is critical. They make sure everybody plays by the rules. But it is a limited role. Roberts' memorable metaphor has defined his image for his first two decades as Chief Justice. It has shaped his reputation in the press as well, which has largely cast Roberts as a modestly conservative institutionalist whose greatest interest is in the integrity and stability of the court. Anti-democratic proposes the opposite. That while Roberts has been praised and portrayed as a model of modest judicial restraint, his effective baseball analogy has helped disguise a quite different and much more radical approach on the bench. Each landmark decision begins with a smaller case that invites the next big question. It allows Roberts to look like an incrementalist when he is really a patient bulldozer. Precedents would be overturned. Strikes would be called balls, but there would be no sudden lurch. Judicial modesty would be false, accompanied by the Chief Justice's carefully choreographed two-step. Roberts' actual legacy is far more powerfully grounded in Shelby County and other cases about voting rights, campaign finance, and the basic operations of our democracy. Roberts endorsed Shelby County's arguments that the VRA was an outdated relic and a violation of Alabama's sovereignty in a sweeping majority opinion, finding that argued, in the absence of anything resembling firm and credible evidence, that things had changed in the South. Roberts' ahistorical reasoning overruled the VRA's calibrated formula for establishing and implementing pre-clearance requirements. In one astonishing blow, Roberts neutered the VRA's primary enforcement arm. Red state legislatures, having spent weeks preparing for this decision by prepping new election laws that would make it tougher for blacks, Latinos, young people, and other Democratic-leaning constituencies to vote, began enacting these draconian new provisions.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.